Right, so can you hear me okay, Peter?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you're loud and clear. Just going to check we've got full free on the controls. There we go. And away we go.
Compton Radio, Golf Romeo Romeo, rejoining from the north.
Golf Romeo Romeo, runway 26 right hand and the QFE 9092.
26 right hand, 9092, Golf Romeo Romeo.
Interesting aircraft to manoeuvre on the ground because it's quite a light aircraft, it's got lots of wing area. It's also got no brakes on it, so when we were starting we had the chocks in. Once the chocks are out, we've got a metal tail skid at the back which drags in the grass, and that provides the only braking. So when we want to stop, you close the throttle and then just wait for the aircraft to slow down by the friction caused by the skid dragging through the grass. So you've got to make your mind up in plenty of time.
Off the radio, Golf Bravo Romeo, off to the...
How do you know where you are when you're in the air?
You use features on the ground, like towns, major roads. I mean, I live locally to here. I live in Farnham, a little village just down the road here, so I've flown around here for lots of years and I recognise all the features, and if the worst comes to the worst, if it got really bad, get my mobile phone out. I've got an aviation app in there, which has got an airspace avoid, which has got all the up-to-date aviation chart there, so it's got all the form of restricted airspace on it and everything like that, and the inbuilt GPS, so there we are. All set to go?
Yeah, absolutely.
Set to go full and free, there we go. So the clubhouse will be on our left hand side, so you can give your wife a wave as we go past. Just
be honest, I actually thought it'd be a hell of a lot slower.
Well, we are going quite slow. We're only doing 65 miles an hour at the moment, and with the headwind, we're actually only going over the ground about 40 miles an hour.
It just seems incredible.
But look, we're already at 800 feet. We're going to level off at about 1,000 or so. Successful beaten the designer and photographer lived there for about 30 years, I think. But more recently, it's been owned by Guy Ritchie and Madonna. Madonna's not with him anymore, but Guy Ritchie still owns the place and is still sometimes seen down around the local area around here. Over one of the big country estates at the moment, known as the Rushmore Estate, which many years ago covered thousands and thousands of acres of southern Wiltshire and North Dorset. And the big house down here that you can see just below us now, that was originally the house that went with the estate. But what happened during the Second World War, they moved all the schools out from the London area because of the bombing, and one such school called Sandroyd moved into that house there, and the owners moved into a big house in the village. And I don't know if it was with their agreement or not, but after the war the school stayed there and is still in that big house to this day. And so the owners of the estate have got a big house in the village, but not the house that runs the estate. Now, if you have a look right out on the horizon, in front of the left wing, can you see some buildings there underneath the white clouds, some kind of white, light-coloured buildings?
Yeah.
Well, that's the docks at Southampton we're looking at.
Long, you can all see away then.
Well, just bring the nose round, so those buildings are just to the left of the nose now, that's the docks, and then if you go a little bit closer to the nose, you can actually see the big chimneys sticking up, which are the power station and the oil refinery at Forley, at the entrance to Southampton Water.
Yeah, it
really is good visibility, so we've got a strong wind pushing us that way, so we've got to turn back the other way, otherwise we'll end up at Southampton if we're not careful. A bit clearer now, you can make out the strip of water, the Solent, between the mainland and the island there. And of course, Burwood is nestling out in these trees here, so a very kind of a wooded area where Burwood's located, isn't it? On the edge of the New Forest, basically.
Yeah, it is, right on there. I know where you are now, yeah, it is, yeah.
Now you're saying about, locating where you are, well the towns are obviously useful, railway lines, major roads, coastlines, rivers and things like that. Now there's a big road underneath us at the moment, running east-west, and because I'm local I know which road that is. It's the A354 and it's the main road that runs from Salisbury to Blandford and then Dorchester. So there we are, so we're just turning parallel with it now, so we're basically running westwards now, and about 7 miles ahead of us is Blandford Forum, so that's very useful, and you can see that ties in with the coastline. We're running parallel with the coast now, and that shower that I was talking about, that's moved away from towards the edge of Poole Harbour, so you can actually make out the harbour a little bit easier now.
Yeah, is that actually hammering down over there?
So is that what?
Hammering down, is that really?
Oh yeah, that's rain, you can see. So that big cloud above it is a shower cloud, and the kind of reduced visibility underneath, that's rain coming down.
We'll go right then, please.
I've been flying all afternoon, we've been kind of pecking our route so that we've avoided the showers, and but I think it's all going away now. So the weather's coming from our right-hand side, from the kind of Bristol Channel area, and it looks like it's going to be a nice evening now. So we've had a little look around the area now to see what's going on, and would you like to have a little go at doing some flying then?
Yeah, why not?
Okay, so if you come on the stick with me, so I'm still flying it, just hold it, just two fingers in the thumb like I showed you, and we're looking through the windscreen at the horizon to try and keep the aircraft level. So first of all we're going to do a turn to the right, so here we go, the stick's going to the right, the aircraft starting to roll to the right and turning, and the stick is now back in the middle, and the aircraft is still turning to the right. I'm just making small movements to try and keep it in a constant bank, and then to come out of the turn, I'm going to move the stick back to the left. There we go. Aircraft rolling to the left. And well, we're level, so I put the stick back in the middle, and we're going in a straight line. Okay, so very, very simple, just very small movements, so you've got the controls, don't worry, you can't break it. Just try keeping it going in a straight line initially, see how it goes. Go to the left now, so let's stop and turn to the left, so stick close to the left. Just a little bit of back pressure, just bring the stick back towards you a bit. A bit of back pressure. There we go, that's it. Get the nose up onto the horizon. That's perfect. And then we'll roll out to the turn, so stick goes back to the right. And there we are, and we're going in a straight line. That's good. We're heading towards Atlantic Forum there. Now I know you're concentrating on flying, but the field's down on our left-hand side. There's vehicles down there because they're just starting to get ready for the Great Dorset Steam Fair, which will be going on there in about 3 weeks' time. So about 600 acres of fields there that are just getting being prepared ready.
Down here 6 years, this is the first year we're going.
Yeah, we're here. I've been several times and it's a great event, and you know, even if you're not particularly interested in traction engines, but it's just a great kind of event. Well worth at least one visit.
No, I'm an officer, I actually love it. I built one when I was a teenager doing the apprenticeship.
Well, you can see the visibility of the Poole Harbour has cleared quite a lot now. You can see it in quite detail. You can see the big island in the middle, Ramsey Island, and the entrance to its sandbanks. Well, you seem to have got the hang of this now. We're going along very nicely.
I might actually hold it for six.
I do? Well, would you like to carry on doing some flying?
Yes, that's alright.
Yeah, you carry on flying it. I'm going to turn to the left then, okay? So off you go to the left. There we go, and then roll out of that mouse, it goes back to the right. And there we go, we're going in a straight line. So we're just over the top of the Blanford Army Camp, just underneath our left wing at the moment. And the town of Blanford itself on our right hand side.
I bet they get to see you doing this every day, don't they?
Well, we don't do it every day. Normally we do Saturdays and Sundays. I normally do maybe one day a week through the summer season. But it's great to keep this thing flying, and it's kind of a hobby job for me. I'm retired really, but this is a piece of living history. The aircraft, 82 years old. There's a lot of aircraft younger than this that are just sitting in museums that you know, don't fly. So the fact that we can take people like yourself flying in a piece of history, I think is absolutely great.
Absolutely, I couldn't agree more. I mean, we go around museums a fair bit.
Yeah. It's great to have things in museums, but if you can have something that can carry on working and you can actually see it, how it was meant to be used, it's even better, I think. Now the visibility along the coast is really good now, so we're pointing just about at Portland and Weymouth at the moment. You might be able to see a big lump of rock on your nose, but if you look out to the right, you can see the sun sparkling off the sea out to our right there. And where the coast is right down there, that's just about where Lyme Regis and Bridport is.
That's brilliant.
So on this flight we've seen Southampton, we've seen the coast right down as far as Lyme Regis, and we've also seen across to the Burnham-on-Sea and the Bristol Channel. So we've seen a massive area of the UK all in one flight.
That's brilliant. It really is.
We CV just below us at the moment, there's some solar panels here. There's a lot of farmers seem to be going into this now. And two fields here, another one further over there. Okay, let's start a gentle right turn in there. So we'll go around the outside of Blanford. River running around the outside of Blanford down there, that's the River Stour. It wends its way down and flows into Christchurch Harbour eventually.
Is that Blanford down there on the right then?
Yeah, it is, yeah. If you look out to your left on the end of the left wing there, you can see the Isle of Portland really clearly. From here it looks like a bit of an island because you can't really see the causeway and the harbour that joins it up to the mainland.
Have you ever flown the Spitfire?
No, I haven't. You have to be very lucky to be invited to fly one as a pilot, or if you buy a flight in one, it costs an awful lot of money. So I haven't had the joy of that yet.
Yeah, I looked into it. It's a couple of grand, a couple of thousand.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, Tiger Moth is much more viable alternative. Right, so we're heading northwest again there. So Blanford going underneath our right wing. Up a little bit during the flying around. We're 1800 feet from where we took off from now. You can see that when you get up higher, the horizon is a lot further away, so we can see a massive area of Dorset and Southern Wiltshire just, you know, scanning around the horizon at the moment.
Yeah, it is. If I've taken my hand away from it,
yeah.
Will it maintain altitude?
Yeah, just take your hand off. I've got it trimmed out, you see, so it's, so there, right, it's flying, it'll gradually, you know, if it gets rocked by a bit of turbulence, you know, one wing might drop, but it's going along, basically on its own at the moment.
But, and it actually, will actually level itself up once it's been knocked about a bit?
Not necessarily. Look, what I'm going to do is, just take your hands off a minute, I'm just going to put my finger on the stick and put it into a turn, and then just release it. So here you go, I'm just... So take your hands off, so I'm just going to, there we go, so I've just put an input in, I've taken my hands completely off now, so it's gone into a turn, but it's going to stay in that turn like that, and what's happening now is the nose is starting to drop, but let's just see what happens. It should accelerate and the nose should come up a bit then, so let's see if it'll do it. No, it's going to go a bit fast, so I don't want it to go, there we go. So over a period of time, even when it's straight and level, if the wing drops, of course, it starts to descend, and you know, you do have to do something about it.
Yeah, I didn't mean actually literally. Like, I know.
Well, I just wanted to show you, you know, that it is basically stable, but eventually it will diverge away from a kind of a level flight path, and you know, if the wing drops and the nose goes down, it does need a human input. It won't just carry on flying on its own accord. But it is actually, when we took off when we were near the ground, it was quite bumpy down there. Well, when you get up here, away from the ground, I don't know if you can feel the air is a bit smoother up here. And, of course, when the wind is blowing over the surface, there's a lot of hills around the airfield there. And the wind gets deflected up, and it goes up, and it comes down. And when you're flying through that, it's very turbulent. But when we get higher up here, the air is a little bit less disturbed, and you can feel that you know, we're going along a lot smoother now.
Yeah, I think I've been sort of getting up grips of that. As soon as you get to, well, not a certain altitude, but up higher, it just calms down.
No. Now, the airfield, you were talking about knowing where you are. Continuous airfield is quite difficult to see from the air, especially if you're a visitor and you're not used to what to look for, because it's a grass field and it's surrounded by green fields and trees, so it doesn't actually stand out very well. It's kind of right to the nose beyond those wooded areas in the middle distance. So coming in from this direction, you don't actually see it until we're right over the top of it, but luckily because I live locally and I can see where we are, I know exactly where it is, so that's not a problem. But you can imagine if it was a visitor coming in murky conditions, it would be quite difficult. But what you do in a case like that, if you're not using GPS, you navigate to somewhere that's easy to find, like Shaftesbury. There's a lot of major roads that lead into Shaftesbury, so you plan your route to navigate to Shaftesbury, and then once you've got to there, the airfield is just 3 miles southeast of Shaftesbury, so it would be very easy, in about 90 seconds flying, it'd be very easy to find the airfield from Shaftesbury.
That was going to be my next question. Before GPS, how did they find it?
Well, you know, dead reckoning. You know, you get the winds beforehand, and you calculate your headings to fly and how long it's going to take, and you map read, and it's a bit like how you navigated on the road for sat navs. You know, you plan your route, you have your chart in your hand, and you draw a line on the chart, and you navigate along it using features on the ground.
There's many, many books and tales of old pilots during World War 1 and 2, they would actually land and ask something.
Yes, that's the one way of it. But I'm going to turn the radio up now, so you might hear a little bit of chit-chat. So the plan is we're going to come back, fly over the top of the airfield, out the other side, and then we're going to make a right-hand circuit around the field, and we'll end up coming into land the same direction we took off. And one thing you'll notice, as we get lower, you'll start to feel as being just thrown around just a little bit. Well, not too bad, but just you will notice it. The radio's turned up now.
London Radio, Tiger Flight XK Tango, rejoining from the south, look up there, Bill information.
265-992.
265-992, XK Tango, joining dead side.
So we've told them on the ground and any aircraft that are in the circuit, they're listening on the radio that we're coming back to join the circuit, so at least they know what we're doing.
Quite fair of the way there,
isn't
it?
Oh yeah. Oh, just turning in now.
Bravo, X-ray Tango, final statistics to that.
Golf Bravo Whiskey, Uniform Hotel, radio check taxi, please.
625, 26 right, 1022, QNH.
26 right, what's the QNH again, please? Golf Uniform Hotel?
1022.
1022, thank you, Golf Uniform Hotel. Still for a moment.
I see the turkey and the sandwich.
Laugh out loud, golfing over my town.
Right, so this is the last flight of the day now, so we won't be stopping in front of the clubhouse where we went from. We'll be going onto the concrete apron because we'll be refueling it and putting it in the hangar to bed.
Right, brilliant, thank you ever so much.
Well, I think you had the nicest part of the day for flying. The visibility has been absolutely stunning, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's just amazing what you... Well,